Hey, it's your guy Tyrrell back with the interviews. Uruguay, Saudi Arabia. Uruguay knock an improved Saudi Arabian side out of the World Cup, but how do they do it? Don't worry, here at the interviews, we've got you covered. So on this edition of the interviews, we're gonna briefly break down how Uruguay got the better of Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, Uruguay, Group A favorites against a Saudi Arabian side that was thrashed by the hosts in the first game. Uruguay knocked the Saudis out of the World Cup. How did they do it? Because they struggled to score in the first game. They changed a few things up. Let me break it all down. Uruguay still in that 4-4-2, but they didn't play Diarrasheta and they didn't play Nandez. They turned to Sanchez, they turned to Rodriguez. And we look at Saudi Arabia, they dropped into more of a narrow 4-5-1, looking to clog the spaces between the lines to ensure that no one could really break through. However, Uruguay, now more of a possession-based side since the turn of the year, found ways to combat that. How do they do that? Well, when you look at it, you look at Saudi Arabia's shape, very narrow. You have the wide players on Uruguay kind of pushing forward, but look at all that space in the channels. How are they going to cope with that? And that is where Uruguay targeted. You have Bentancur, you have Vecino dropping a bit deeper into spaces where they know that Al-Faraj won't step forward, where Otafe won't step forward. That was one of the big issues there. So they were able to pick up the ball in these deeper positions, and they have the range of passing to get the ball bypassing the midfield and into attacking players. It was an issue that Poland had yesterday. Uruguay were able to combat it because there was no press on those two in deeper positions. And what had happened was they simply pushed Casares and Varela forward. We look at one play where it's Vecino picking up the ball, clipping the ball over the defense to Varela in half space, tries to find Suarez. He does, but Suarez fires his shot into side netting. Bentancur found Casares also in that space, driving into the half spaces to pick up the ball. His pullback didn't work either, but it was signs that they could get into those areas, and it wasn't only them. We saw Vecino tried to pick out Rodriguez, also charging into that space. He wasn't able to keep the ball into play, but it just shows that they had an area where they could exploit. They could go long, they could go short. And you look at the first few minutes, a simple ball over the top into Cavani, and he nods it into Suarez, and Suarez almost gets a great goal scoring chance. That is how this Uruguay side were able to bypass Saudi Arabia. It was a big problem for them, because when we look at the breakdown to the goal, yes, we're going to look at the goalkeeper's mistake, Suarez breaking free in the box, but the buildup to that saw Vecino step a bit forward, finds Cavani dropping deeper into midfield to get on the ball, and he found spaces in that half space for Rodriguez to drive forward. He pulled the ball back, earned a corner kick, and it led to Suarez's goal. That was how Uruguay kind of combated with Saudi Arabia's shape in midfield, and that was pivotal. And without the ball, they were a bit better, but there were some warning signs. They dropped a bit deeper, two banks of four like we expected. One of the big issues here was not the fact that they didn't stop Otafe, because Suarez and Cavani did take turns kind of dropping onto him to ensure that he couldn't control the game, but it was the main fact that Rodriguez was a bit higher and Babri was able to pick up the ball in these spaces. There was one chance where he picked up the ball in a pocket of space and fired a shot on goal that Muslera had to push over. But Saudi Arabia, the problem with them was simply this, and it's a big problem. They started Al-Mawalad, which is key, because he tried to run in behind, gave them something different opposed to Al-Salawi, and he offered a presence in the box. But just too many players in central positions, and against a Uruguayan side that is very good without the ball, you are going to pay. Look at how many players clog into this area. You have the wide players pushing in, you have the midfielders pushing in, and how are you to create any chances when no one is making deeper runs? And it was so easy for Uruguay to just stay organized, follow their marker, and ensure that they could close spaces down. And that's what they did, and in the first half that looked like perhaps Saudi could get something going. In the second half, they didn't really have much of a threat. The second half was also different for Uruguay because we saw the variation of Suarez and Cavani. Suarez getting a lot of stick for, he did score here, but not playing to the standard that many people hold him to. However, here in the second half, he was more of a facilitator, dropping deeper into pockets of spaces to pick up the ball, playing with his back to goal. We look at one play where he's able to get the ball, switch it out to Sanchez. Sanchez delivers a cross into the box. The substitute, Laxalt, breaks in, doesn't get his shot on goal. We look at another opportunity where Cavani drifts out left, cuts in, plays the ball to Suarez, tries to make a run in behind, but Suarez can't combine with him. But that was one element where they were going with that. We also had Cavani pushing out to the left channel. There was one play where Suarez was got fouled. Cavani drifts into that space. He locates, he waits for Sanchez, clips the ball into the box. Sanchez is unmarked. He should score. He doesn't. Uruguay found plays in the second half through a different element. They worked through their center forwards. Although they didn't really combine well, they were doing different things. Cavani should have scored late on when he made a great individual run into the box, but he was denied by the Saudi Arabian goalkeeper. But that's what we saw from Saudi in that, and from Uruguay in that aspect. They were able to push Cavani out to the flanks. They were able to drop Suarez in, play with his back to goal, offer a creative element. And that's the other difference between them and Poland, where Poland's forwards were kind of staying up front. Here, Uruguay have Cavani and Suarez who could move into different positions, great all-rounder, stretch the play, get on the ball, and that was key for Uruguay. They took off Rodriguez, they brought on Laxalt for more defensive presence down the left. They brought on Torreira for Vecino, who offered more of a penetrative option, could play passes into the forwards, instantly opposed to playing balls wide and looking for longer balls over the top. And that is how Uruguay combated with Saudi Arabia's improved shape. They used the half spaces and the channels in the first half. The second half, they relied on Cavani and Suarez's ability to move out wide, to play with the back to goal. They weren't as impressive as many would have expected, but like Portugal earlier on in the day, they got the job done, and that is what's most important. Again, defensively, Godin, Jimenez, superb, not conceding a goal, and the fact that they're able to win games without Suarez and Cavani at their utmost best is a big worry for all the sides in this World Cup, because if those two get going with the way that they're playing now, they could cause a lot of team's problems. But let me know what you guys think. Meet me in the comments below. Don't forget, I upload videos every day, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. And that was your daily dose of the InnerViews.